fellow Trek Chatters, I'm Pit Trekkie, and welcome to another episode of Pittsburgh's Trek Chat. So for today's episode, what I'm going to be doing is reviewing Episode 7 of Season 3 of Star Trek Picard, Dominion. So the episode opens up in the Chintaka system scrapyard with Seven of Nine talking with, appears to be, Captain Tuvok, talking about them being fugitives and trying to get Tuvok to help them. What Seven of Nine is really doing is trying to get Tuvok to talk so that way they can analyze his voice to see if it actually is Tuvok rather than a changeling. At first his voice comes back as yes, it is Tuvok, but as he continues to talk, it starts to come as inconclusive. So Seven of Nine throws a curveball and talks about arranging a meeting with him on Acolon 7. And that's where she said that she had her neuro pattern stabilized. And when Tuvok says, sure, we'll do that, she realizes this is a changeling because she says that no Vulcan would go to that planet after the anti-Kolinar parades or protests, and that her mind, her neuro patterns were stabilized by the real Tuvok on board Voyager. At this point, the changeling says that they're basically as good as dead. Picard comes around and says what has happened with Riker. The changeling morphs into Riker and basically says, he's as good as dead, just like you. So Geordi realizes at this point that maybe they should just accept it, that the Starfleet has been severely compromised. And Picard says, we're on our own. So what we find out in a briefing is that Worf and Raffi are monitoring Starfleet security at Exoport and are trying to figure out what happened to Riker at this point. So far, there's nothing in Starfleet records that says that Riker has been captured. They talk about the morality of trying to stop the changelings. Dr. Crusher feels that they might have to find some sort of, or create some sort of tool to stop these changelings, but if it goes into the biological era, it could be similar to what they did with the virus with Section 31 back during the Deep Space Nine era. And so they realize that Frontier Day is only 36 hours away, and they're trying to figure out what is wrong with why the changelings stole Picard's body. So basically what they realize is they need DNA from Picard's body and blood from Jack to create a near-perfect doppelganger of Picard so that they can access the Frontier Day festivities. So, and Geordi believes that the M510 golem that they just found might have the answer. So they go and talk to this android, and Data comes out, but then he fluctuates between Data and Lore. And we find out is that Alton Sung and B4 are in there in the personalities, but they're more memory files, where Data and Lore were basically designed by Sung to kind of, there's a partition between the two, which they feel that they were supposed to integrate so that Data would kind of realize finally what it was like to be fully human. But Lore keeps coming out and seems to be more dominant. They do try asking Data and Lore, basically, about why the changeling stole Picard's body. There was some sort of comment about Iremotic syndrome and whether or not that was some sort of issue or not going on with Picard. And eventually they just shut down the M510 droid because Data's starting to say, help me, Captain. And it brings back a lot of negative emotions from Picard about having to say goodbye to Data twice. So we then skip to on board the Shrike, where Vadic is talking to that whatever it is from her hand, basically saying that they need Jack Crusher, that they are not to, she is not to fail them, and that basically even though they have their enhanced physiology now, these changelings are just, quote, malleable meat, and that they can be molded and they can be basically harmed, and he threatens them. So he says, we must have the boy. So again, still this big obsession with Jack Crusher, all right? At one point, on board the Titan, we see Jack and Sydney in a turbo lift. Jack is starting to kind of flirt with her, saying, I found these really nice quarters. What are your quarters like? Maybe you can show me your quarters. She realizes that he's flirting. She's talking, she's having an inner dialogue about how she wishes he would just be less subtle and just kind of do something like touch her hand, which he ends up doing, because apparently he's hearing her thoughts. And she even is like, why? How did he know that? And at one point, his eyes glow red, and he saw vines growing behind Sydney. So that those issues are still going on with his hallucinations at this point. So we also find out that the Titan is starting to get some sort of transmission. Another long-term search is showing that Starfleet is trying to find the Titan from different points where they're hiding. And they end up getting a code that shows that Riker has been compromised and that it's actually coming from the Shrike. So they try to block the signal. All right. Jack and then Picard are actually in the observation lounge, and Jack is talking about how he wishes that nobody was dying for him. He doesn't feel he's that perfect or that important. And he tries telling Picard about some of the images and things that he has going on in his head. And Picard says that he feels that they could actually use Jack to their advantage. So the Titan ends up moving into open space in the Alpha Quadrant and looks dead. And the Shrike actually ends up tracking them to this spot. All right. And the Titan appears to have been attacked by a Vulcan cruiser, and they hear a recording saying that they had engaged the Titan and that both ships were severely damaged. So Vadic says that they have to board the Titan to see if Jack is over there. And so they go by shuttle. They don't transport. She makes it very clear. They have to go by shuttle. And so they get on board the ship, and they see Jack appear, and Jack says everybody's dead. But Vadic takes a scan of the ship with this tricorder she has on her arm, and there are some life signs. So she knows he's not being honest. And she says she wants to take him to a better place, and Jack asks, what place? And she says, better to show you than to tell you. So that's very, very interesting, that line. Well, and what ends up happening is Jack ends up leading them on a chase through the ship. It turns out this was a big planned trickery to capture Vadic and the other changelings. So they set up force fields throughout the ship, and they finally get barricaded. Vadic ends up going into sick bay. She ends up seeing Jack, and she gets put behind a force field at this point. And Shaw is actually surprised that they actually caught Vadic at this point. During this time, Vadic starts whistling the notes to Three Blind Mice, and Beverly confronts her and asks her what she wants with her son. And she also talks about how, at this point, she is questioning her oath to do no harm. She's rethinking that promise. I mean, what mother wouldn't when her child is being threatened by some sort of unknown force for unknown reasons? All right. And then Picard comes in from behind, which Vadic kind of taunts about how cute that is, and he talks to Vadic about how they know the Frontier Day, they need a near-perfect double of him so that they can pass security, and that they know about the evolved physiology. And Vadic says, do you know his physiology? And Beverly is like, what are you talking about? And basically what Vadic says is, he's not for me, but not really for you either. So this ends up leading to basically a story that Vadic gives about why she is the way she is and why the changelings basically had their evolution. So what we find out is that in this kind of monologue is during the Dominion War, she and nine other changelings were captured by Starfleet, and they were taken to Daystrom Station, and they were experimented on with a lot of different pain, just different things that they were trying to do to see what they could subject them to. And they were kept in tubes, basically, on a shelf. Well, there was this one doctor that was leading what's called Project Proteus. And what we find out through all this torture that they're doing of the changelings is that they're trying to make a perfect spy so they can actually infiltrate different alien races by these changelings being able to not be detectable. All right? And you can tell that Vadic has been really scarred by all of this. And she talks a lot about the squeaking of the wheels and boots and hearing doors and hearing different types of screams, whistling. So the Three Blind Mice tune was actually what this doctor was whistling while experimenting on all of them. At one point, Vadic ends up getting the upper hand, killing the female doctor, and she ends up taking that doctor's image as a memory for her to fuel her hate. At this point. So while they're talking to Vadic and all of this is going on, what happens is when Jack and Sydney are trying to capture the changelings, what happens is they get themselves stuck in the middle of a corridor, and there are three different directions where the changelings are at, and the force fields are starting to fail. So Geordi is trying to get the force fields down, that he and Micah are unable to do it, and we find out that Laura is starting to take over the functions of the ship, and he basically feels the enemy of my enemy is my friend, so he decides to help the changelings out. So what ends up happening is the force fields end up failing, and Vadic ends up getting away, and then the changelings end up attacking Jack and attacking Sydney. So Jack ends up killing his changeling, but he's able to telepathically connect into Sydney's mind and tell her, basically telepathically, what moves to do. He's kind of like miming it while she's fighting, and she finally gets the upper hand on the changeling, and his eyes glow red and her eyes glow red, and she's like, "How did you get into my head?" And basically at this point what ends up happening is they're able to get away. Geordi has this talk with Lore trying to get through to Data. And Data finally comes through and he's able to return control of the Titan back to the crew. But what ends up happening is Vadic ends up getting the upper hand. She ends up, and she and the changelings end up getting to the bridge and taking over the ship. And that's pretty much where the episode ends. At this point. So just some thoughts about this episode. I think it was really nice that we got to see Tuvok, which was a nice little surprise. I wasn't expecting that. And based on the rank pips on his collar, it looks like Tuvok has been promoted to captain. We don't know where Tuvok is at right now or what has happened to him. All that the changeling basically said is that he's, I have the quote here, death will come as a relief to him when they're done with him, which they basically say will happen to all of humanity or all of the Federation. All right. So it was nice to have that little tie-in again. The Beverly and Picard story with the moral dilemma. I love that we saw this because I think that this is what was missing in the first two seasons of Picard, is that people were just killing people randomly and it just didn't seem, there was no remorse or anything to that effect. Yeah, like with Elnor and the swords. And so to actually hear two of these officers saying, here's the morality of our situation. Starfleet created this virus in the past and almost destroyed this entire race, you know, and they did it because they wanted to save the Federation, Section 31. But at the same time, is this really the right thing to do? If we need to stop them somehow with some sort of tool and it's going to be used based on biology, is this moral? And it's interesting to see how that shifts as the story goes and moves forward, and we have Vadic, and Beverly's becoming this protective mother who wants to protect her son at all costs. She wants to know the answers as to why these changelings want her son so badly. And, of course, Picard's wondering this as well. What really surprised me was when they decided, you know what, we brought Vadic on board this ship. And Beverly even says, it's the moment we brought her on board, we invited death on this ship. So they're clearly going to get ready to kill Vadic at that point. But they were just stopped because the force fields went down at this point. So very, 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 very interesting. It would have been dark to have seen them actually do that. We've never seen Picard and Crusher do that before. And personally, I wouldn't have liked that. I would have rather they tried to subdue her. That just seems to be the more Federation way. But I guess really we'll never know 100% sure for sure what she did. But it really brings into that moral question: what are you going to do as a parent? What matters at that moment more than your own child? You know, what means will you go to stop somebody from harming your child or taking your child? All right. The history of these changelings. This was actually, I'll be honest with you, that's how I know that this was a really good story. You know when a story is really good when you actually feel an emotional connection or it hits you in a certain way. Watching that whole thing with the changelings, that really hit me hard. Knowing that human beings captured these 10 living sentient beings and not only tortured them, but also tried to change them and mold them into killing machines to do their bidding at this point. Now, obviously in this episode, they didn't say specifically it was Section 31. It was just Starfleet, basically, it seemed like, that was doing these experiments. But obviously we know from the previous episode, we know that Daystrom Station is a Section 31 research outpost. So we know this had to have been a team of Section 31 people. But still, at the same time, these are 25th century humans. Going all the way back to the earliest iterations of Star Trek, humanity was supposed to have evolved, where they would not engage in torture and hurting others to gain something. Yes, obviously in times of crisis, sometimes people go to their roots, basically, and I think that's what happened with Section 31 during the Dominion War. They resorted to, they justify why it was okay committing genocide against an entire race to save billions or trillions, you could say, with the Federation, the Klingons, the Romulans, and then anybody else who might have been involved, you know, or eventually conquered by the Dominion. You know, but it's still hard watching these so-called evolved humans torturing and just having, being sociopathic and having no emotion about what they're doing. I mean, the doctor was whistling three blind mice as she was torturing Vadic and the other changelings. It's a scary moment. It's hard to watch something like that in a Star Trek episode. But it does show, it's interesting that Star Trek's always been about the human condition and the darkness in humanity, even though we have emotionally and morally evolved as time has gone on, to see that happening, it's just very difficult to watch. But, I mean, it is another part of the human condition, is that darkness that we all carry, okay? Definitely, we're learning more and more about Jack, what's going on with him. So now we know it's not just his eyes glowing and him having these hallucinations. Now we know he can actually, he's got telepathic abilities to some degree, where he can hear the thoughts of other people, and now he can actually communicate and actually control people. How is Jack going to use that moving forward? And also, now that we see that his relationship with Sydney seems to be blossoming even more, how's that going to end up turning out? Now that she knows that he can get into her head and even control her, is that going to turn her off from wanting to be with Jack? Is that going to question his motives? Or is that going to eventually just bring them even closer and closer? Who knows? All right. The other thing I really enjoyed about this episode was the Geordi Data story. Geordi never really got to say goodbye to Data. If you think about it, the last time that Geordi had seen Data was at the end of Nemesis, when they were on the Enterprise E and the transporters were down. The Enterprise was severely damaged after it crashed into the Scimitar. And what ended up happening was, is I think Geordi knew Data was going to go and rescue Captain Picard, but I don't know if he actually knew that Data was actually going to sacrifice himself. All you saw at that moment, they didn't say goodbye to each other, they just nodded at each other and smiled. And then Data leapt off the ship and went on to the Scimitar. So we never, Geordi never had a moment in the end of Nemesis where he said, wow, how he was affected by Data's death. And now we find out that it broke him. He felt completely lost without having his best friend with him. And that he wanted, and that through Data's death, he learned how much that friendship meant and that Data had meant to him so much and helped shape the person that he is. And now he didn't want to lose Data again. And so he used that love, that passion to finally bring Data forth and be past Lore. So the question is now, is Data going to stay there permanently, or is Lore still going to have a little bit of control, and are they going to flip back and forth? And then are they going to eventually finally integrate, or will Lore somehow be destroyed and Data takes over and we have a completely restored Data once and for all? It'll be very interesting. So some of the likes that I had about the episode, I liked at the very beginning, the Chintaka system scrapyard. So we know that there was a big Starfleet battle, the Battle of Chintaka. We actually saw the Chintaka system a couple times during Deep Space Nine. It was in the end of the sixth season finale, when they were getting that array that we ended up seeing in the Siege of AR-558. The Dominion also, in the later part of the seventh season, attacked that base and managed to get the base back, AR-558, and that's where the Breen used their weapon that was actually able to cripple all the Federation Klingon and Romulan ships, which led to the destruction of the Defiant. So it was nice to see that little throwback to the battlefield that was there. Really cool. It was nice getting to see Brent Spiner playing both Data and Lore again. I mean, it's like he didn't even miss a beat. It's like 20 years never went by. He was just able to fit right back into these characters. Very interesting seeing how Lore, at this point, he needles our crew, makes fun of them for the way that they've aged. You can tell that he's got a lot of anger and resentment toward Picard and his crew for some of the things that he's gone through in the past. But again, there's a message there that good conquers evil, and Data was actually able to come forth and save the day and help bring the control of the Titan back to our Starfleet crew. Some of the questions that I have moving forward here. What has happened to Tuvok? All right. So we know that he's been captured and that basically death will be too good for him, or whatever the changeling said. I really do believe, I think if we saw the changeling Tuvok, I can't imagine that we're not going to see the real Tuvok and see that resolved by the end of the season. So I guarantee you that Tim Russ is going to be back as Captain Tuvok at some point before the series ends. So we also know that when Seven of Nine was talking to the changeling Tuvok, they mentioned Admiral Janeway and her being involved in Frontier Day. Mentioned Admiral Janeway several of the times throughout this season, so I'm starting to highly believe that we're going to see Kate Mulgrew back as Admiral Janeway. I can't imagine that we won't see her in some capacity as a surprise. I could be wrong about that, but I really believe that we'll see her. So why do they need Jack to make a complete genetic double of Picard? I mean, they have his body. Why can't they just clone him and they'll have a complete replica? I don't understand why they need Jack's blood in addition to Jack's DNA. How's that going to make it any better? I mean, wouldn't it be kind of like a Jack and a Picard mix at some point? I mean, it just seems a little odd to me, but maybe we'll find more about that as time goes on. Another just a minor question. How did Data remember about the scimitar and him going on board to to go and rescue Picard? If you think about it, when Data transferred his memories to B4, this was before the Enterprise E actually arrived at Romulus in Star Trek Nemesis. So I don't know if that was just a little continuity gaffe that happened, or did maybe something happen off screen where Data tried again later on to download his memories to B4, and that's how he knew about the scimitar. Not sure. Again, another question is, who is this contact of Vadix, and why is it working with the changeling? So there's got to be some sort of deeper meaning, some sort of deeper plan going on, that the changelings are kind of being used to do some sort of higher cause for what's going on. I know there are rumors online that this could be Gul Dukat, it could be a Paw Wraith, it could be some sort of thing that's controlling the changelings. I get the feeling that creature is not a changeling, especially the way that he talks to Vadic and to her people. So I can't wait to find out what that creature really is. Are we going to see it, or will it always be just kind of like a changeling kind of view of it? Let's see, how is Jack able to hear Sydney's thoughts and eventually control her? I still think that there's some sort of changeling manipulation that went on. I wouldn't say that Jack is maybe full changeling. I'd be really surprised if he is. But maybe they tried experimenting on him to some degree at some point. Who knows? But I mean, Vadic had even said to Picard, Beverly, that their son was never meant for her, but never meant for them either. So... also, Vadic makes the comment to Jack about how she wants to take him somewhere, and he says, where do you want me to take you? And she said, it would be better if I show you, which makes me wonder if there's some sort of Great Link kind of situation that's going on with Jack. I really believe there has to be some sort of changeling influence over him. But again, I could be wrong, that's just my guess. All right. Why do these changelings insist on using shuttles versus transporters? This goes back to episode 5, where Ro insisted on shuttling over to the Titan from the Intrepid. Now, we know that she wasn't a changeling, but maybe those two security guards who were with her who were changelings maybe try to convince her in some way that couldn't be trusted. So there must be something with transporters that affect this upgraded physiology of these new changelings. So another question I have is, why are the other changelings cloaked and masked? Why don't they show their faces? Was there enough damage or some sort of scarring or something that happened where they were being experimented on that led to them hiding their appearances? I'd like to really know what's underneath those masks and those hooded robes. Let's see here. And then again, like I said earlier, will Lore or Data finally take over? I guess we're going to find out in the next couple of episodes. We ended with, at least we know that Data has taken over and he's in control at this point. So we'll see what happens. But basically, that's my review of Episode 7 of Season 3 of Star Trek Picard. Please watch the video and feel free to comment below. Let me know what your thoughts are about this episode and my review of it. What are your thoughts on my theories about what's coming up in the next 3 episodes? You can obviously follow the show on YouTube. Just type in Pittsburgh's Trek Chat in the search engine on YouTube. It'll take you directly to my channel. You can follow the show on Facebook, facebook.com/Pittsburgh's Trek Chat. You can also follow the show on Twitter at PGH Trek Chat. Looking forward to the next episode. Until then, Mayans live long and prosper.